Liquid Glass was announced at WWDC 2025, and it is a huge design change for all of the Apple platforms. In this video, I'll explain 5 things you absolutely need to know before you start converting your apps or building a new one with Liquid Glass. We'll talk about why you shouldn't overdo it with glass everywhere, how you should think about glass as a floating layer above your content, why you should be very selective with your use of color, why the word concentricity will now be in your vocabulary, and how to make these new glassy app icons that are unified across all platforms. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. In case you aren't familiar, let me give you a quick overview of what Liquid Glass is and some of its properties. Liquid Glass is a new material that bends and shapes light and moves like liquid. Right? The current materials, you see, they scatter the light. Well, now with Liquid Glass, it bends and shapes it kind of like in real life as you were looking at it through glass. And you can see this all over iOS, iPadOS, macOS. It's a unified design language across all platforms. You'll see it in the tab bar, buttons, menus, controls, toolbars, and more. Liquid Glass also responds to your gestures and touch, like with fluidity, and then the animation of them morphing and adapting to each context, like when a new screen has different items in the toolbar, you can see it morphing to the new items. It can switch between light and dark mode based on the content that's underneath it, so it's still legible. And there's also some very subtle reflections of the nearby UI elements all around it. This is an insane level of attention to detail. I love it. Not everyone does though. Like, this was just announced, and of course, some people love it, some people hate it. But guess what? If you hate it, it doesn't matter, because just like everything, right now it's like new, bold, change. People don't like change, but guess what? Give it 3, 4, 5, 6 months, people get used to it. Now, if you don't want to update your app, you hate Liquid Glass, you're going to go a different route. Well, your app is just going to look old and dated as people just get used to it. Like, that's just how things work. A lot of people hated iOS 7's flat design, but guess what? If you had a skeuomorphic app in the age of iOS 7, it looked like the app was not updated, neglected, no longer maintained. So even if you don't like Liquid Glass, you're going to have to adopt it. So let's talk about some things you must know before you adopt it into your app. And first things first, use the built-in SwiftUI components. I've long been a long-time proponent of this advice. Don't create all your custom components. The main reason was because it's a lot of work, and if Apple ever does change the design, like they're doing right now, you change with them for free versus having to completely redo all your custom stuff. Because not only do you adapt to the new design when you use the built-in components, but they have all kinds of accessibility and all other bells and whistles built in that you don't have to rebuild from scratch. So that's basically the gist. If your app is using the basic SwiftUI tab bar, toolbar, menu, button, slider, you didn't build your own, you're basically going to get this update for free. So that's the first thing you need to know. All this cool morphing animation, look, reflections, all that cool stuff, you just get for free as long as you use SwiftUI or UIKit's built-in components. Now, if you do have a custom component, you can give it the glass look using the glass effect modifier, but you got to be careful with this because Apple recommends not overdoing the glass. And that brings me to the next point. You need to think of the glass as like a control layer over your content. For example, the tab bar or the toolbar or a button. You'll notice in a lot of Apple's apps, that's where the liquid glass is, and they're like floating above the content, and the content goes underneath it, and the content is what shines through the glass. So you don't want to do glass on glass on glass on glass or put glass everywhere. Again, the main idea is think of the glass layer as the controls that are floating above your content, so your content can shine through from underneath. And if there's just glass everywhere, there's no visual hierarchy, it just clutters up the UI and makes things confusing. And speaking of making things confusing, another key thing you need to know is using the toolbar spacer API. Because you'll see these toolbars, there's a lot of individual buttons, but you can group related buttons together. But another thing to look out for is this new design language uses a lot more icons than text. And you want to be careful not to group a text and an icon because it may be confused as one button and not two separate things. So how you space out and group your toolbar buttons is also something you need to keep in mind. So for this point, the key idea is the liquid glass controls are floating over your content. It's like a control layer. Don't use glass on glass on glass, and intelligently space out and group your toolbar items. Now let's talk about color and how that fits in with this new liquid glass design language. To put it simply, you want to use color very sparingly. One of the reasons for this is that the symbols and glyphs and text on these liquid glass items will change from light mode to dark mode based on the content that's underneath it. That way it stays as legible as possible. However, if you use a color here, well, you're stuck with that color no matter what's underneath it, and in certain circumstances, it might not be legible. Now, of course, that may not be applicable to your app. Maybe your app doesn't have any content scrolling underneath these buttons, but it is something to keep in mind. Color should typically be used to direct the user's attention to the primary action on that screen, as you can see with this blue checkmark button up here. So use color to draw attention. Don't drown out everything with color. And Apple recommends if you do need some color in your app, use it in the background content layer, not on the liquid glass buttons or toolbar items. So the main idea, use color sparingly and use it to direct the user's attention to the primary action item. A good example is this view bag button here. Another concept you're going to need to know is the concept of concentricity. Now, I know what concentric corners mean, right? It's where the corner radius like lines up, but I had never heard the word concentricity until WWDC 25, and I felt like that was all I heard for a day because it was in so many of the sessions. But basically what they're doing with this new design language is, for the longest time, Apple's hardware has had the same corner radius. I don't know if you've ever put your iPhone on top of your MacBook, but the edges will line up perfectly. Same thing with the iPad. And now Apple is leaning even more into that with the software. So the softwares, the buttons, the corners will actually line up with the curve of the hardware, just making it feel, I don't know, just very satisfying and like it just fits and it belongs. So because Apple's leaning into this so heavily on their apps, your app is also gonna have to lean in heavily if it wants to feel at home in this new liquid glass design language. And some common examples of this are content that's in a card. You can see here where the corner radiuses, corner radii, whatever, don't line up perfectly. It just feels off, doesn't feel like it fits. So make sure your content is concentric with the rest of the UI and the edges of the device. Again, common example here is buttons that are like in the lower left-hand corner or in the lower right-hand corner. In liquid glass, they recommend using the capsule shape because the capsule naturally lends itself to concentricity. And Apple has some nice SwiftUI APIs that can help you out with that. So as you're rebuilding your UI with liquid glass, keep that top of mind because that is a very important part of this new design language. Concentricity. Learn it, remember it, use it in your UI. The next thing you're gonna need to know is very important because you're gonna have to redesign your app icon. Because in liquid glass, app icons now have layers, glassy translucency, blurs. But don't fret, I did just say you're gonna have to redesign all your app icons. Apple has given us a tool called Icon Composer that can do the vast majority of the heavy lifting for us. So you don't have to be some awesome designer that can design a beautiful glassy app icon. All you gotta do is give Icon Composer various layers of your app. If you've ever created a VisionOS app or app icon, you'll know that that takes three layers, and then the system takes those layers and blows them out in 3D into the VisionOS, but all you had to do is give it layers. Well, this is similar, that you give Icon Composer basic flat layers, no glass effect or anything like that, and Icon Composer will give it the glass effect, and then you have control to adjust the translucency, the blurs, you know, change things around. And at the end of it, it will spit out this icon file, which here's another big deal. We no longer have to have a Mac icon, a watch icon, a VisionOS icon. All the icons are unified into this one icon file. And as you can see, you get all the various tint modes with it as well. And all this is created in Icon Composer. Now, Icon Composer deserves a full tutorial in and of itself. Can't give you that tutorial right here in this video. But what you need to know is you're gonna need a brand new app icon. The good news is it shouldn't be that hard to do with Icon Composer. Now, if you're here learning about what you need to know for liquid glass, I know you're building an awesome app that is going to be up to date and look beautiful here in a couple months when iOS 26 is released. And I think it's a great idea to have a website to showcase your app, showcase your work, or maybe that app needs a website itself. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.